You know, about to kill these stalks down through there. I can tell when I was about done with it.
You could?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to let you count stalks if you want to. Huh? If you'd counted them when you was cutting, you could tell when you was about done if you counted them now.
I don't have over 300 in that first row. I know I ain't cleaned that much stalks yet.
What living in Appalachia means to you?
Oh, well, it's a good way of life. It's a good, we are kind of thought of, I guess, as backward people, but we are neighbors. Most everybody's friendly. Most everybody will throw up their hand when you meet them. And most people take you with as a friend till you prove them different, or until they're proven different, whichever, you know. Because most people in Appalachia take somebody as a friend, and because that's the way we're used to being, is friendly with each other. Most everybody, if they see somebody in need, they try to help. Sometimes you don't have a lot to help with, but such as you have, you know. And there's little things you can do that help, when somebody's in need. And most everybody's neighbors, we're just neighbors, and that covers a lot of territory, being a neighbor.
So tell me what it means to you to live in Appalachia.
Safe. It's a good safe place to live. Friends, neighbors, you couldn't beat them anywhere else. I wouldn't live anywhere else, you know. If you need something, all you have to do is holler at your next door neighbor, or if I'm off working anywhere on Grapevine, I can holler at anybody on Grapevine, and that means a lot, doesn't it?
You say you got about a half acre in this field?
Yeah, I've got almost a half acre of cane. These few rows on the first side is sugar drip that we planted in May, last of May. We planted it with a planter. And I've got about 15 more rows on the other side of it that's we set with a tobacco setter. Transplanted out of the green, started it in the greenhouse and planted it. And hopefully we'll start making molasses next week if the sugar content comes on up in it. It's 15 now. The heads need to turn a little bit more brown. The heads are now a green. That head will get a brown color, and they're not now. There's juice in that top, so that top needs to get to end at least to dough. It needs to actually get hard. So this that I planted is not ready yet, but I was hoping that the later the transplanted would be ready. but it's been slow about getting ready. I'm having to wait on it. So hopefully next week I can start.
Have y'all been growing cane? How many years you been doing cane?
10 years here.
At least 10.
Maybe 15. Some of 15.
But every year we learn something new, don't we, Buster?
Oh, yeah. Get it ready to run through the mill. We run 5 or 6 stalks at a time through the mill with a 13 Chattanooga. Mills run, we grind with the horses. I grind about an hour with one, switch out, grind with another, rotate them so they can keep walking pretty fast, so we get a whole lot of ground. About 60 gallons, 70 gallons of juice, and then I'll pour it in the pan and start boiling. It takes about 5 hours to boil a 70 gallon lot.
Well, we have 3 horses, and he takes it turnabout with them because they get tired of going around and around and around and around. And they just hook the horse in. The horse pulls the cane mill, and the stalks go in, and of course the mill squeezes the juice out, you know. And so somebody's got to keep cane carried off out the trailer over to the cane mill, off the trailer to the cane mill, and then somebody's got to keep the cane stalks moved where it grinds them out. You have to keep that moved. Somebody does. So just takes 2 people there. But then he'll run that horse for a little while, and then he'll switch it out to the other horse so they don't get so tired. The big Percheron draft horses we used to have, we had one of them that would get drunk. I mean, he would stagger. And you better take him out, because going around and around, I reckon he got unbalanced or something. But the little horses, the smaller ones that we have now, the Belgian and the Halflingers, they don't get drunk going around and around.
Thank you.
Well, we build a fire about 8 o'clock in the morning. Fill the pan up with the juice out of about 70 gallons of juice. Get a hot fire under it. We bring the juice in with the barrel from the mill. We use the horses to grind it, press the juice out, and then we put it in this vat. Get a good hot fire going. It takes a lot of wood to get it good and hot. We try to keep it boiling good and hot for about 5 hours. And this process I'm doing, skimming, I have to keep the chlorophyll off the top. So we keep those skimmings off to keep it out of the juice so the molasses won't be green. We take it off with the board. Skimming process. Try to keep it boiling good and hot. It gets to about 225 degrees, then they're ready to take off. It's a long process. It's mostly standing here over the fire, sweating. On the hot days like today, on the cool days, it feels pretty good.
Heaven, it's again today. We're grateful, Lord, for this day that you blessed us with. We thank you for being mindful of us again. We know it's in you that all things are done, and we're grateful for this day. And thank you for each one that's gathered here today. We know that your mercy, the Bible says in Lamentations chapter 3 and verse 22, it says it's by your mercies that we're not consumed. And the next verse says they are new every morning. We thank you for this day and your blessing. Thank you for your people today. You know the need, and you said you'd supply it according to your riches and glory. We thank you. Bless the food that's been prepared for the nourishment of our bodies. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Know what to do, Father Preacher.
Follow the preacher.
Follow the preacher.
That's what I love with all these dinners.
Yeah, I know.
I heard you in reference.
When Mr. Norton decides it's time to take them off, and he's the one that decides. When he decides it's time to take them off, they set the pan off. He has to have somebody to help him. He gets one end, they get the other end. And they set it over on the boards and let it settle down. Depends on how much foam is on top, how much you let it settle. But then we put it in it's not a stock pot, but it's a big, huge canner. And then we run it out of that into the glass jars. And I order my lids, the one-piece lids, and you put them on there. I don't put the lids on. I usually sit there and run the molasses into the jar and hand it off to somebody because they're red hot. You can't touch anything except that rim to hold it, to fill it. And then you got to get rid of it because it's hot. And then somebody else puts a lid on. Somebody sets it over on the counter. Somebody else puts a lid on. And that's when you're through.
Okay, I've got about three different checks. I check with the thermometer, and I need to be at least 224. And then I checked with the skimmer when they go to curtaining off, when that goes to curtaining all the way off, they will be wide spots in it about an inch wide, flake off at one time instead of dripping little drips. They're just about there. And then I do this. I take that when I can move my fingers 2 inches apart and that string hangs together instead of falling apart. I can tell how they taste too.
I make her picture and say cheese, so she knows, say cheese.
We throw the rocks in the creek, didn't we?
You throw rocks in the creek. You throw my rocks in the creek.
We throw the Buster's rocks, didn't we?
You throw my rocks in the creek?
Yeah, we throw
I the... haul them in, and then you throw them in the creek. Boy.
That's Mr. Barnwell, if you can get down now.
Molasses making is hard work. While the days are long, having family and friends you can count on to help out makes all the difference. Throughout the day, as Buster and Jessie and their crew work the cane, family and friends stop by to share stories and catch up. At one point, there were over a dozen folks at the shed visiting. The icing on the cake is that people left with a few quarts of great-tasting molasses, each jar produced with the loving hands of their friends and neighbors. Buster and Jessie are two of the hardest-working people I've ever met. Their individual talents complement each other, and what they can accomplish together is truly amazing. They're a funny and loving couple, and spending time with them and their friends was a wonderful experience that stayed with me long after I returned home. Over the time I spent with these folks, I made new friends, and the rich experience left me knowing that I was part of a strong community, one with deep roots in the Appalachian Mountains.
If you share my interest in the people and places I call home, be sure to hit the like and subscribe buttons to learn more about this way of life. On this channel, I hope to continue to honor the people, vibrant culture, and strong traditions of Appalachia.